or sense of what you believe is right or wrong at any point in time. The conscience is a precious gift from God, and it should be guarded, protected, strengthened. It's worth protecting. Only humans have a conscience. It was funny in the book he talked about one of the guys had a dog who appears to have a guilty conscience because his tail is between his legs. But no, animals don't have conscience. And then, of course, he said, cats don't have a conscience, but you already knew that. But it is true. Animals don't have a conscience, only humans. It's an aspect of being made in the image of God. In our consciences, each one is personal. No two consciences are exactly alike. And so I have things in my conscience, stances, convictions, that don't exactly match any of yours, including my own wife. That's the closest relationship in life, and even our partners, our spouses' consciences don't exactly match ours. Only one person's conscience has ever matched God's conscience perfectly, and that's the Lord Jesus when he was here on earth. Only his has exactly matched God's will in this life. The conscience is not the same as the voice of God. God and the Holy Spirit certainly work in and through our conscience, but it's not one and the same. We need to be careful not to assign that to the voice of God. The conscience does act as a guide, a monitor, a witness, and a judge in our hearts. And it can change. It can change positively or negatively. It can be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin, and things that before bothered us no longer bother us as it gets hardened by sin. It can be changed by following the standards of others. Again, either positively or negatively in how we allow ourselves to be led in the culture, in our family, among leaders. It can also be conformed more and more, and this is how it should be, to God's word, to the truth of God's word, as well as external truth, but primarily the truth of God's word should be guiding, strengthening, changing our conscience more and more to be in conformity to his will. In the book, they talk about two principles that should guide how we view the conscience. One is that God is the Lord of the conscience. Your leadership, your spouse, the government, none of those, even yourself, you're not the Lord of your own conscience. God is the Lord of the conscience, and he has the right and ability to define what it should be and how it should change. The second principle in the book is that you should always obey your conscience. This is very key. You should always obey your conscience. If you believe that eating bacon is wrong, and I'm not saying that just like John was saying before, I'm not saying that to criticize or belittle that because that's a very serious issue for some people. If you believe that that's wrong for you, it is wrong for you. Someone else might have freedom to eat bacon based on revealed truth in God's word. And that would be correct for them, but for you it'd be wrong. And so we should never violate our conscience. Even if it's uninformed, what that should prompt us to do is to inform it by God's truth, but we should never violate our conscience. You can see there I have a little asterisk behind that because there is one area in which we shouldn't listen to our conscience, and that's when God is changing it and strengthening it. So in that example of bacon, if you have grown up with that conviction that it's wrong to eat bacon because it's pork and that's, you know, an unclean animal from the Old Testament, and you see in God's word that he, in the New Testament, declares all food clean, and there's nothing that defiles the man. It's what comes out of the heart that defiles the man. You might be strengthened in your conscience to then partake of that. And that'd be a strengthening of your conscience. The first time you do so, however, you might feel those pangs of, this is wrong, but you need to submit that to the Lordship of Christ and say, no, he is strengthening my conscience, calibrating it, as we're going to talk about, to be stronger. And in this case, it's not sinning against my conscience. It's actually going to a higher authority, and that is the Lordship of Christ. So that's the exception, what we would say, when you shouldn't listen to your conscience, when it's being strengthened and more freedom is being added. As we come to Christ, our conscience is often supercharged because the Holy Spirit opens our eyes to God's holiness and our sin. And we see in our walk this gap possibly growing greater and greater. My knowledge of God's will and a gap from that between that and my true obedience. And that can drive us to despair. But as they say in the book, don't let that drive you to despair. That causes you to run and flee to the cross. And appropriate the truths of 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Hebrews 9 says, how much more will the blood of Christ, who offered himself without blemish, cleanse our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? The blood of Christ, the gospel, is a cleansing agent of our conscience. And so as we see the gap between our obedience and God's standards, sometimes with a very sensitive conscience, that gap seems to be growing and growing as I'm supposed to be getting closer and closer to conformity with God's word. Don't let that drive you to despair, but rather to the gospel, to the cross. Also part of review, what do we do if the conscience is not functioning properly? Well, what do you do when you have a piece of machinery that's not functioning properly? You calibrate it, you conform it, align it to a standard so that it works properly. And you do that by training it, by educating it with truth, again, primarily through God's word, the truth of the word, the gospel, letting that just flood our minds and hearts and strengthen our conscience. There's also some external truth that we need to be open to. There are things in science or just life in general, even economics, that help to inform our conscience. For example, what's the best immigration policy that we should adopt in our country? God says to welcome strangers. And yet there's economic things that have to be considered and so forth. And so there's truth outside of God's word that also needs to be come into play appropriately as we work in our conscience and train and strengthen it. Sometimes we need to add to our conscience and sometimes we need to subtract from it when it's oversensitive and God's word gives us freedom. So any questions, just as I do welcome questions, we have a lot to cover, but if there's any burning questions, please feel free. We'll have some time hopefully at the end as well. Anything on this review from the last number of weeks with the men teaching, anything that has not made sense or burning questions? Or else we'll move on. So chapter 5, this is where the rubber meets the road. This is where it's really practical. I hope this is a very practical session for you. Most of the book has been talking about my own conscience inside, how do I strengthen it, but it's more focused on me and me working with my conscience. The stakes and the complexities increase when we start now having to interact with other people. And so this chapter is how do we relate to fellow Christians? What do you do when your conscience allows you to do something, but your friend, your brother, sister in Christ cannot do that thing? How do you respond to that? What if the shoe's on the other foot? They have freedom to do something that you don't have the freedom to do in your conscience. How do you respond? That's a very practical question, and we need to be considering that. In the book, they talk about practicing spiritual triage. For those who are in the medical field, triage is a very common practice. When you're in the emergency room, you have 10 people come in at the same time. You don't serve the best-looking one first, or the tallest person, or the shortest person. You have a sorting method, and they call that triage, to sort according to priority and urgency. And in the same way, there are in the spiritual walk, there are some things that are more important to take a stand on than others. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, I deliver to you as of first importance, and then he goes through the elements of the gospel. There are all scripture is important and true. There are some aspects and tenets and positions in Scripture that are more important to hold to very firmly than others. And so this verse just talks about there's some things that are first importance, and those are hills to die on, as we're going to see. I illustrated it this way. They talk about three levels of issues. The first level of issues are essential to being a Christian. If you don't hold to these things, these tenets, these doctrines, we would very seriously question your genuine faith in Christ. There is one God in three persons. Jesus Christ is fully God and fully man. We're saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, to the glory of God alone. Those are sound, very central tenets, doctrines, that if people don't hold those are hills to die on. Those are reasons to separate. Those are reasons to take a stand. You can see that that circle with a one inside of it has a dark, solid border. There is some very, this is well-defined. There's some well-defined things in Scripture that are key that we must hold to truly call ourselves Christians. Then there's a second level, and it's banded by a shade of gray and also dotted because there's a little more leniency or freedom. They define these second-level issues as creating reasonable boundaries between Christians and churches. For example, things that would be difficult to reconcile if there was significant disagreement between the leadership in a church and the members of a church on, for example, mode of baptism. So here at Southside, we immerse people. We believe that's the biblical mode of baptism that is called for in the New Testament. If you have a strong background and belief and conviction of paedobaptism, which is baptizing infants, you are very probably, we wouldn't question the reality of your faith in Christ. There are true Christians who will be in heaven who hold to paedobaptism. In this church, it would be kind of difficult you'd be disappointed if you were hoping that that would be proclaimed and supported from this church. And so second level issues help to kind of define